Are you willing to give up everything to follow Christ? In part 3 of The Cost of Discipleship, we will find out what it truly takes to be a disciple of Jesus Christ.
As we look at this text this morning, the text says that there was a large crowd that was following Jesus, and he turned to address them. Just about any time in the scriptures that you see a mention of a large crowd, fasten your seatbelts, get ready, get yourself prepared, because there's a hard teaching coming behind it. If anyone comes to me, he says, and does not hate his own father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. The main point of discipleship, Jesus indicates that we can't prefer or love no one more than him if we are going to be his disciples. This extended even to our family relationships. If anyone comes to me without hating his mother and father, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Now, hate here is not used in the way that we use it. It means lesser than, lesser value, to prefer above. The Hebrew language, for some reason, has very few comparative words, like the English language, such as more, less, greater, fewer, bad, good, is the English. Hebrew does not have that. So in ancient Hebrew, if one were to prefer strawberry ice cream to chocolate ice cream, one would say, I love strawberry, but hate chocolate. But what hate means here in content is I prefer strawberry. I'll take chocolate. It's not that I dislike chocolate, but I prefer strawberry. So that's where the word hate means in the scripture. So what Jesus means is that we cannot prefer anyone or anything to him. He's first. He's number one. And Jesus says, I must have absolute priority over the closest human relationship in your life. That's why he uses the people that he used, mother, father, sister, brother. He knows those relationships are the closest to us in our human life. If there's anyone in your life that can talk you out of obeying God, you need to walk away from them. Anyone or anything that keeps you away from God has too much power in your life. Anyone or anything that can keep you from your Christian walk has too much power in your life. Anyone or anything that can pull you into unrighteousness has too much power in your life. If there is anyone or anything that can make you not do for people of God, or the church body, the church, they have too much power. See, where we make a mistake with that is, we have a lot of people that say, well, I don't do people. Well, you don't do Jesus. I hate to tell you, but see, you can't be a disciple of Jesus and not do people, because that's what he is about. People. He loves people, and what he did was for people, for us. We cannot be a part of something and say, we take it personal. See, what you have to do when it comes to the body of Christ, this is not a personal thing. This is a God thing. What I do for you, I may do it because I do love you, but you know why I really do it? Because I love God. You really don't have anything to do with it. I can pick on the choir. See, the choir has to be here at a certain time. They have to wear certain clothes. They have to look a certain way. If they don't come to rehearsal, I don't care if you came to rehearsal last week, but if you don't come to rehearsal this week, you can't sing this week. If you're late, you can't sing. Okay, well, you think they do that because they like Damien? I love Pastor Brown. And I'm sure they do too. But they don't do that because they love Pastor Brown. They do what they're told to do because they love God. They do what they do because of God. People that are in the church serve you because they love God. They don't serve you because they love you. And you might have a little bit of love in it. But the reason I really do it is because of the God in me. So if your boss instructs us to do something immoral, then we are supposed to step back and say, I can't do that. So do we get it? Do we really get it? No one is to have priority over Jesus Christ and what he teaches. The word hate here may not be literally mean hate, but on the second thought, if Jesus really does have priority in your life, it may cause somebody to say, you are so devoted to him, I think you hate me. And that's how they may feel, but that's not what it is. We need to look at this very close. Since too many of our human relationships cause us to sinfully compromise our walk with Jesus. Some people and some things have too much power in our lives, a power that really belongs to God. Let's look at the cross. He said you had to bear your own cross. The cross is laid at every Christian. As we embark upon discipleship, we surrender ourselves to Christ in a union with his death. We give over our lives to death. The cross is not a terrible end to an otherwise God-fearing and happy life, but it meets us at the beginning of our communion with Christ. When Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. That's Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the cost of discipleship. Today, the image of the cross has been taken and it has been polished. See, we dress the cross up now. We wear it as a piece of jewelry. And we'd be proud to wear it. Oh, it's shiny and it's pretty. And the prettier they are, the more we want it. But see, the cross in Jesus' day would just shine up an electric chair. If one of your relatives or you had to do an electric chair, one of your relatives, would they have an electric chair made of gold and shine it up and make it real pretty and put it on their neck? Or if you had to get the injection and they were going to keep, would they take the syringe and tell a jeweler, make me one of those syringes. I want to wear that on my neck. Would we wear that? Because when we wear a cross, that's what we're doing. We're wearing the death of Jesus Christ. So would you glorify a electric chair? Paul understood what it meant to carry a cross. In Galatians, there were three dynamic verses about what it means to carry a cross. I have been crucified with Jesus, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Galatians 2:20. Those who belong to Christ has crucified the sinful nature with its passion and its desires. That means your passions and your desires have no rule and regulation over God, that they're under control. That's Galatians 5:24. May I never burst except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, though which the world has been crucified to me. That means the world has been crucified and is dead to me. And I to the world. That means I'm dead to the world. Galatians 6:14. That means that there is nothing the world has to offer that interests you. It is if the world is dead to you and you are dead to the world. But Jesus points to the cross, not to torture us, because it's the only way to the glory. See, that's the only way you can get there. You can't go but one way. You gotta bear your cross. And bearing your cross means you have to die to who you are. So it's no other way. In the world ye shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Hear what he's saying. You have to bear your cross. There's tribulation. But he said, that mean him. That mean it's already done. That mean he's there for you. He has already taken the lick for you. So even though you have to go through tribulation, even though you have to go through whatever it is that God is putting you through, but he's right there with you. Right there with you. Now, for a little while, you may have to suffer various trials. You may have to go through. He didn't say that this cross meant that you didn't have to go through anything. That's 1 Peter 1:6. This wisdom is already evident when we consider that even in this world, all of what we most value, family, talents, career, achievements, all come at the cost of a sacrifice. You have no one that has achieved and gotten above and did not sacrifice. Michael Jordan didn't become who he was without practice every day. He didn't become who he was without mandating himself to do what it was that he had to do to become what he had to become. People don't become great with no effort. You don't become great if you don't put an effort into it. See, Michael Jordan, they say that even after games that he had played and maybe he had won, he would still go back to the court. After he would change clothes, go back and bounce the ball over 500 more times. Wake up every day and just go shoot free throws. Just stand there for hours and shoot free. You don't get good at something until you sacrifice something. You have to give up who you are to become what God wants you to be. To develop your gift, you got to give up time. You got to give up sleep. You got to give up something to become something. Nothing in this world is free. Sacrifice brings on blessings. See, when you sacrifice something, that means you get something back. And 9 times out of 10, what you get back is the desire that you wanted. It feeds you. That's why they always say, do what you like and you'll never be broke. That's what the world say. If you put your energy into something that you desire and like, they say you will never be broke. And this is what I used to tell my grandson. I still tell him, the world look at, this is how I kind of change it to the way I look at it. You got to be hungry. If you're not hungry, you won't go get it. See, you got to be hungry for something. See, when you get hungry, like Alicia said, you'll go looking for it. And you look around and then you say, wait. If that didn't work, let me try another way. See, you gotta be hungry. See, when you're not hungry, you'll lay in the bed. See, when you're not
won't go seek it. When you're not hungry, you won't go looking for it. But when that hunger rise up in you, you'll manifest that gift that God has put in you. But it's going to take some sacrifice. Jesus is not into pain for its own sake. He don't just want us to be in pain just to be in pain just because it's pain. But because sacrifice brings blessings. You cannot be a disciple unless you are willing to give up control of your life to Jesus. And that's hard to do. And none of us, from the pulpit to the door, wants to do and want to give it up. None of us do. But that's the only way. In other words, what Jesus meant, we are dead people and we should act like we're dead. The value. Jesus presents the image of a man who plans on building a tower. Before he begins the construction, he must count the cost to see if he has enough resources to finish the job. Now, this is the cost of discipleship, not the cost of salvation. Don't get it twisted. Salvation is free. Discipleship is a cost. Before you embark on the Christian life, if you stop to be asked, did I have enough to finish? Do I have enough to finish this thing? Do I have enough in me? Do I have enough stigma in me? What do I have? The answer would always be no. Always. Because it's not our resources that are necessary to finish. See, that's the thing you got to understand. This thing is a hard thing. It's a hard thing. But you can't rely on your resources. Your resources are not what it takes. God provides all that you need in order to finish the project. Now, that's a blessing right there. That's a shout right there. When I find out all that he asks of me, all that he desires of me, all that he needs me to do and put my hands to work, but he's going to give me the resources to be able to do it. God is the builder who finishes the job called salvation. See, you got to understand, he's the builder. He's the construction worker. So he's the one that's going to finish. In Philippians 1 and 6, Paul said, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it to the completion. Jesus is talking about the cost of total commitment. That means I'm not going to leave you out there by yourself. I'm going to get you out of here, but I'm not going to leave you out there by yourself.
Nothing worth having comes without a cost, but we must be willing to pay the price. You cannot pay the price for discipleship if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. If you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, or perhaps you need to renew your fellowship, repeat these life-changing words after me.
I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in my heart he arose from the dead. And now, by faith and according to your word, I receive the gift of salvation, forgiveness of sin, and everlasting life. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Congratulations and welcome to life. And until we get together again, we want you, yes, all of you, to enjoy life.
If you're missing our Family First Friday night, you're missing out on big fun. Next up, June 2nd, Life Comedy Jam. See you there.
In 2017, we made a commitment to do more as a church family. So bring your family, tell your friends about all the events going on here at your church.
Worship in the Word every Thursday from 11 a.m. to noon, and again from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. 1 hour of power. You don't want to miss it.
I need to know you got my back. You got my back. You got my back. You got my back. Because see, at some given time in the work that I do for God, I got to turn my back. But I need to know that there's somebody behind me that ain't gonna let nothing come up behind me. So I need to know, do you have my back? Can I trust you with my back?